Hello, it's Reija and welcome to another video. Today I will be sharing with you my January reading wrap-up. I read a total of 6 things, 2 of which were graphic novels, and I'm just gonna combine my graphic novels and book reading for this month. So let's get started. I am going to be talking about the graphic novels that I read first, starting with Chew, the Omnivore Edition Volume 1. And I have a bit of a mixed feeling with this graphic novel. I felt that the premise about this detective who can eat things and then determine where that piece of food has come from, and like to minute details, and that means that he can solve crimes by ingesting, for example, body parts and determine how that person has died. And the premise sounded really interesting. I heard that it is filled with dark humor, so I thought that I'd give it a go. And I have to say that I liked the different sort of superpowers, like the whole knowing what where the food has come from when you eat it, and also there's this woman who can write such vivid descriptions about food that she makes her readers relive that experience and such. I thought that the food-related superpowers were really interesting. Some of the humor was also pretty good, but it was kind of a mixed bag. Every time there was this sort of subtlety in the humor, I really liked it. But when it started getting to kind of bodily fluids and such, that kind of territory, then it lost me, because I'm not really into that. And the biggest crux that made me kind of feel iffy about the book was, in fact, the art style. The art style is not bad. It is actually pretty well executed, and to be able to play with proportions and anatomy in this way and exaggerate it, you actually have to have a pretty good grasp of anatomy in the first place. But this is just not my kind of aesthetic, so the art style kind of kept pulling me out of the story. So I ended up giving Chew 3 stars, and I probably won't be continuing on with the series. But if this kind of dark humor, noir-esque detective story with supernatural elements intrigues you, and you are not afraid of being kind of grossed out, I would still recommend it. This was just a case of me personally not gelling with the book and with the art style especially. The next graphic novel that I read was The Promised Neverland Volume 7 by Kaiu Shirai and Posuka Demisu, and I loved it. I can't really tell you much about the story except for the general premise that it tells the story of these orphan kids who live in this orphanage called the Gracefield House, and they find out a terrible secret lurking behind the scenes and decide to escape. And that's pretty much all I can say. I highly recommend this series because it is really good, and this volume once again was fantastic. It really set up the scene for the next arc. I think that when I look at it in terms of like how this stands on its own, this is a setup volume. So by itself it can be kind of like boring because it really does set up the scene for the next big arc in the story, and it's a lot of like world building info and planning and such. But I think that when I look at it in terms of how it will fit the story arc this will be very good. There were some things like repetitive writing, because this is a series that is running weekly in a magazine. So when they publish it in a volume, all the weekly chapters get put in the one volume, and there is a sort of repetitiveness in between chapters, because there's always this what happened next week sort of vibe, which I don't really fault the series for, because that's just what happens when you are running with a magazine format. But I really like this volume a lot. I've been liking all of these volumes, and I can't wait for the 8th one. It just got released. I am on hold for it at the library and can't wait. I gave this volume 4 stars. Moving on to the books. First book I read in January was The Golden Compass by Philip Pullman. This is part of my His Dark Materials read-along, and I am a terrible host because I was late with my own read-along, and I managed to finish this. I started this in December, but I managed to finish it like 2 days after January started, and I quite liked it. It's not the perfect story. It has a lot of really interesting ideas, but I feel like this is a case where I'm not sure who this is targeted towards. Like, I know that this is a sort of middle grade young adult novel, but a lot of the themes and a lot of the ideas in this book would have flown right over my head when I was the age that this book is targeted towards. It feels, to me at least, a lot more adult. I guess that you could say that it is an all-ages book, but I tend to lean towards the adult side when I'm thinking about this. It is a story about Lyra and her adventures, and going to find her friend who gets kidnapped by these people who are taking children and kind of vanishing with them. And she and one of her friends gets kidnapped, and she wants to find out what happened to him. And there's a lot of like theological themes in this books, and also like themes of adulthood and growing up, and what growing up means, and sort of like sin and how we view ourselves, how we view sin and such. It was really interesting, like not super perfect. Like it is written at the beginning, it moves very slowly, and then by the third act, everything kind of like happens like this. And it felt a little bit rushed towards the end. Like there were some pacing issues. But I liked the high stakes at the end. It was really well written, in my opinion. Like I am really intrigued at what happens next, so I can't wait to pick up the next one. I know I'm late with it, but I'm hoping to get it read this month. And I gave The Golden Compass by Philip Pullman 3.5 stars. Next book I read in the month of January was The Cloud Roads by Martha Wells, and this was a real surprise. I wasn't expecting to enjoy it as much as I did. I first saw this book mentioned on Rachel's channel, Kalanadi, and I really liked it. It was interesting. This is about shape-shifting kind of dragon-esque lizard people, and I loved it. I loved the culture. I loved reading about a fantasy world that didn't have any like humans in it. Like there are humanoid races and humanoid species, but there weren't actual humans. And I really liked it. Parts of it felt a little bit info dumpy. Like, you are reading a paragraph where characters are talking, and then suddenly there's like three paragraphs worth of world building detail thrown into the mix. So that was a bit awkward to read at times, but I really liked it, and I can't wait to continue on with this series. And I love all the characters. There was so much nice banter, and Stone especially is my old grumpy grandpa, and I love him, and I'm so attached to all of these characters, and I was so thoroughly entertained by this novel. And I can't say a lot more about it. It is about this character called Moon, who has pretty much always been alone, and he doesn't really know who he is and what he is. And then he finds this older creature who is of the same species as he is, and he becomes his mentor and takes him to his home, and shenanigans ensue. And it is a wonderful story, and I loved it so much, and I gave it 4 stars. The next book I read was Sadie by Courtney Summers. This was January's pick for the BookTube Discord server, and I really liked this as well. I listened to it on audio, and I felt that it was very well acted and very well produced. I really liked the audio version because there were multiple actors and sound effects, and it was following this kind of podcast interview format interspersed with Sadie's character point of view. And it is about this girl called Sadie who has lived a bit of a rough life, and her sister gets murdered, and she is on a quest to find her sister's killer. And then in a future timeline, or a present timeline, there's this podcast host who is looking into Sadie's disappearance. And I really enjoyed it. I gave this book 4 stars. I think it was very well executed. I was on the edge of my seat. But the reason I gave it 4 stars is that I don't think there's a lot of reread value. I feel like this is a book that you kind of consume and then and you enjoy it, but then you kind of forget about it. So it will not be like the next all-time favorite, but it was highly enjoyable, very good, and I think that it explored some very interesting topics. Content warnings for child molestation and child abuse and also cutting apply. I also enjoyed that there were some subtle queer themes in this book, but I haven't heard a lot of people talking about those, so I thought I'd mention that as well. Anyway, highly enjoyable read. And the very last thing that I read in January was Girls of Paper and Fire by Natasha Nyan. And this was kind of disappointing to me. I was highly anticipating this book because I am always on the lookout for fantasy books that explore other cultures than the Western medieval times. I just find them very interesting. And this was an Own Voices novel, so I was doubly excited for it, but it just wasn't that well executed. This is about Lei, who gets taken into the capital of her country to serve as the Demon King's concubine. And I personally think that this book should have either been told from someone else's point of view than Lei, or it should have been a multi-point of view book. Because a lot of the time, my problems with this book were that Natasha Nyan expanded on the world building in really like shoddy ways. Like, they felt like things that she pulled out of her ass, so to speak, because you've been introduced to this set of rules and the way the world works, and then characters are discussing certain things, and then you're introduced to a whole new concept in the middle of it. Like, oh, did you know, by the way, there's this thing? And I was like, yeah, I did not know that, actually. Sure, I guess that's how this works now. And also the borders between Moon, Steel, and Papercast people were really kind of flexible. Like, I had a hard time picturing what these demons were supposed to look like because the rules in which they were described kept changing. So at times I was picturing Steelcast demons as looking more Mooncast than Mooncast demons, you know? Especially the way the king is described, I kept picturing him as much more human-looking than I think he was supposed to be. There were just a lot of inconsistencies that kept drawing me out of the story. There were also, like, a lot of times when characters were doing absolutely nothing. This book could have easily been edited down to, like, 300 pages because there is a lot of filler that doesn't really expand on the characters or explore them in any kind of meaningful way. I also thought that Lei was slut-shaming all of her fellow concubines, and that Lei's pain was sort of made to be this great big thing, and that the fact that Lei was resisting made her more, made her pain more real, you know? Like there was this thing where the other concubines who were also forced to sleep with the king and were sleeping with the king, they were described as somehow being lesser, of lesser value, because they didn't resist. And I was like, no, they are all being held hostage. They are all, like, doing this not because they want to, but because they are forced to. They are all being sexually assaulted. Like, Lei is not on some high horse here, you know? But the way the story framed her, it was like, Lei is the only true good one because she is the one that resists and doesn't want to, like, sleep with the king. And I was like, no. 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 They are all assault victims. You can't diminish the other girls and lift one of them up just because she is approaching the situation from a different angle. They are all assault victims. And that rubbed me the wrong way. Like, that really bugged me, like, a lot. I was angry when I was reading those scenes. And I would have understood if it was acknowledged by the narrative that the way Lei was thinking about this and approaching this was wrong of her, but other characters are encouraging her and actively, like, saying that, yes, you are the good one and you are an inspiration for us. And I was like, no, I'm not here for that. Also, by the end, these characters were, like, doing so much stupid things, like, so many stupid things. Like, they are running around the palace in the middle of the night, training and doing, like, really suspicious things that they should have been, you know, punished for and found out. Are there no guards? No guards anywhere? I thought that the women's palace was heavily guarded. Like, I was so disappointed by this book. There were so many stupid things, like, stupid things. I ended up giving this 2 stars. I probably won't continue on with the series. I have no inclination to. By the end, I did not care about anyone, any character, anything. I was just like, please let me get over this. Like, please just stop. It isn't the worst thing I read. It isn't the worst thing I have ever read. But it wasn't good. And there you have it. This has been my January reading wrap-up. Tell me in the comments, have you read any of these books? Did you enjoy them? What did you think? Do you have completely different opinions on them than I did? I'm interested to know. And also tell me, what are you currently reading? Because I'm also interested to know that as well. I will see you in the next video very soon. Bye-bye!